Thank you so much for coming tonight. Before we get started here, I would like to read a land acknowledgement. The campus of Lewis and Clark College occupies the historic homelands of several indigenous groups. These groups include bands of Chinook-speaking peoples, including the Multnomah, Kathlamet, Clackamas, Tumwater, and Wadalala bands, as well as the Tualatin Kalapulia and the Malala people in the Willamette Valley. Today, the descendants of these indigenous groups are primarily members of the Grand Ronde and the Siletz Confederated Tribes, with Chinook and other tribal relations at Warm Springs, Yakima, and the Chinook Nation. There are also many indigenous groups that remain unrecognized by the federal government, and their stories still demand and deserve to be heard. Our campus chooses to honor Lewis and Clark, two colonizers, instead of the many indigenous peoples that this land was taken from. We ask you to take some time to recognize whose land you are currently occupying and the necessity to return native land, strengthen indigenous sovereignty, and heal relationships with native nations. With this in mind, we urge you to pick up a flyer from our table outside with information about federal recognition for the Chinook Nation.
Hi, everybody. My name is Cameron Kalopsis. I use she, they pronouns, and I'm one of the co-chairs this year. I'm a sociology and anthropology major. Thank you all for coming here tonight, and welcome to the keynote presentation of Dr. Moya Bailey. Yes, definitely. For the past 2 days of events, we have been exploring the ways that digital technologies, internet platforms, and online spaces shape and are shaped by our understandings and expressions of gender and sexuality. The events this year explore the intersections of gender, sexuality, and digital technologies through conversations about work, leisure, sex, violence, family, privacy, activism, self-expression, and much more.
Hi, everyone. My name is Molly Gibbons, and I use she, her pronouns. And I'm a senior history major with minors in gender studies and Hispanic studies, and I'm one of the other co-chairs. Cameron and I, along with our third co-chair, August, are beyond excited to be joined by Dr. Moya Bailey for her keynote presentation titled, What Are Gender and Sexuality in the World We Want? But before we invite Dr. Bailey to the microphone, we have a few housekeeping announcements.
We want to remind you that we have a full schedule of events lined up for tomorrow, so make sure you check out our website for details about all of the events. Please note that registration is required for the community dialogue session tomorrow. You can find that registration link on the website. We'd also like to remind you to visit our student-curated art exhibit in the WATSEC Library, atrium. We'll be hosting a reception celebrating the art exhibit next week on Tuesday, March 12th at 3:30, and the exhibit's going to remain on display until the end of the month. We also have a virtual gallery which can be accessed through the link on the Symposium website and our Instagram page. Speaking of, we encourage you to follow our Symposium Instagram account at LCGenderSymp, where we'll be posting photos from this year's events. This year, we're hosting a raffle drawing each day. For each event you attend, you can submit one entry for a chance to win a copy of a book written by one of our phenomenal keynote speakers. Tonight's prize is going to be one of Dr. Moya Bailey's books, either hashtag activism or Misogynoir Transformed. The winner gets to pick. Tonight's winner will be, okay, yes, be able to pick. And the remaining book will be the prize for tomorrow's raffle. So if you still have a ticket to turn in, please raise your hand and somebody will come get them. But if you guys are good, like the people last night, nobody will have one.
It's okay.
It's okay. Don't feel bad. Oh my God. Look at all you guys. So good at this. Okay. So we're going to draw the winner. We'll announce, but do not come to get your prize. You can get it after the Q&A. You can go see Kim over here, and you can grab it then. Okay. And our winner I'm going to read the number just because I don't want to mispronounce anything. 59. Wait, I'll give you guys a second to get your tickets out. I did this last night. No, it's honestly, there's just one letter that I can't read and I just don't want to mispronounce anything. Okay, is everyone ready? Okay. 5959218. Hello. Okay, awesome. Well, you can, yeah. So go see Kim after for your prize. Awesome, thank you. Okay. So if you were not the one winner tonight, the books will be available outside, hopefully, will be available outside in the reception foyer for purchase. So, yeah.
So after Dr. Bailey's speech tonight, so there will be time for a Q&A, so we encourage you guys to take some notes, jot down some ideas in preparation for that. And please remember that private recordings and photos of this event are not permitted, but photos will be available on our social media platforms next week. So Moya Bailey is an associate professor at Northwestern University and is the founder of the Digital Apothecary and co-founder of the Black Feminist Health Science Studies Collective. Her work focuses on marginalized groups' use of digital media to promote social justice, and she is interested in how race, gender, and sexuality are represented in media and medicine. She is the digital alchemist for the Octavia E. Butler Legacy Network and the board president of the Allied Media Projects, which is a Detroit-based movement media organization that supports an ever-growing network of activists and organizers. Like we've mentioned, she's the co-author of Hashtag Activism, Networks of Race and Gender Justice, and is the author of Misogynoir Transformed, Black Women's Digital Resistance. Both books, like we've said, are going to be available, hopefully, for purchase in the reception foyer after the presentation, and we invite you guys to pick up a copy and get it signed. When the co-chairs and I, as well as our faculty advisor, Kim Brodkin, began brainstorming symposium themes, as well as potential keynote speakers, Dr. Bailey is one of the first people we knew we wanted to invite. Not only is her work directly related to our theme, which is analyzing the connections between gender and sexuality and digital technologies and the internet, but Dr. Bailey has been a very influential figure in shaping intersectional feminist ideology and scholarship for this generation. We feel so honored that Moya Bailey has accepted our invitation, and we're so excited that she's here with us tonight. So please join us in welcoming Dr. Bailey to the podium now.
Hello. Can you hear me okay? Yes. Wonderful. I want to start by thanking Kim and the students for making this visit already just much more than I could have ever imagined. It's been a real joy to hang out with you in just this limited time. I had planned to do my own land acknowledgement, but that is not needed, but I do want to say that some people don't think about land acknowledgements anymore, and we all know that they're not enough. They can sometimes be used to help people feel good or like they've done something when there is more to do. I really love that there's material outside for people to learn more. I am thinking about the indigenous communities who have maintained relationships with the land, and it's important for us to remember that so that we don't let settler colonialism actively work to obscure that connection. And in thinking about settler colonialism, I cannot go without acknowledging the genocide unfolding against the Palestinian people, or the ethnic cleansing transpiring in the Sudan. May we continue to pressure our governments and institutions to call for a ceasefire now. In addition to acknowledging the traditional stewards of the land we are on, I work to make sure my research supports the descendants of those whose enslaved labor make this country possible. I acknowledge the labor of enslaved Africans and their descendants who have enriched this region with cultural and economic contributions that can never truly be quantified, even when they were not legally allowed to settle here. Your campus statue to York is but a small reminder of the colonial and enslaving history of this country. York served as William Clark's slave and helped navigate for the dynamic duo for which the school is named as they ventured west. May we add to this remembrance and acknowledgement of the Congolese miners who mine the minerals that power our digital devices, who make the tech of our institutions and a talk like this one possible. In an ongoing pandemic, amidst multiple genocides, wars, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, and ecological devastation, it can be overwhelming to continue doing business as usual. This talk is not that. So we're gonna do some things that are a little bit different. This talk builds on the work of Black feminist creators, their creative projects, and what those projects spawned. This talk is Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower meets Hometown Hero, Walida Emerisha's Octavia's Brood, co-created with Adrienne Marie Brown. If you read the description of the talk, you may have gleaned a little of what I'm up to. I said, gather round to hear a tale of hope, even as the world as we know it is coming to an end. So I want to think of our time together as a little pocket of possibility, a buoyant bubble in a world on fire. In thinking about my own intellectual journey, the questions of gender and sexuality that we're going to probe here, it was actually stories and storytelling that moved me most. More than facts, figures, or even memorization, stories are what stay. So I come from a small town in Fayetteville, Arkansas, and I took high school Spanish from a Swedish woman who learned her Spanish from her Mexican husband. And this was slightly rural Arkansas in the 90s, and our instruction for Spanish consisted of episodes of the educational telenovela Destinos, and impractical stories of forest elephants eating peanut soup, or a young man named Patricio who llama, la línea todavía está ocupada. So he calls and calls and the line is still busy. And so we learned that story and it's something that stayed with me, but I cannot speak Spanish and I can only speak Spanish in this present tense of the stories that we've learned in class. We learn gender and sexuality through these narratives. Patricio plays basketball while his girlfriend is sad. Gender roles, seriously. Gender roles and the heteronormative imperative were central in my acquisition of a new language, and you know, we can debate that acquisition. It doesn't have to be that way. But because stories stick, I decided to try and tell one here, something to chew on and think about later. Hopefully a story or stories to come back to. I used Midjourney, a subscription-based generative AI tool, which I cannot figure out how to unsubscribe from, to make the images that you see on the slides today. I illustrate with the tool that I critique, hopefully adding another layer to my conflicted feelings about AI, tech, and digital, and the digital in this moment. As I prepared to talk with you today, there was some concern about considering gender and sexuality in the world we want might not attend to the digital as such. And I hope to make clear that the world we want may depend on the internet to our own peril. And concerns about gender and sexuality might need a new framing that's not based in identity, but in how we show up for community. When humans and their identities are no longer the center, which I contend is required for us to survive, we must reimagine life as we know it, which of course includes our connection to the digital, which is too often our connection to each other in this current moment. And now, a story. It was the summer of 2044, and the t-shirt Deja wore stuck to her skin with a wet suction that was usually only possible when one was caught in a rainstorm. Not that she knew firsthand, it's just what she had been told. The press of heat, another record for East Point, Georgia, had her panting like the dog she used to have, but had to let go because that was one too many mouths to feed. She thought about her rescue, Snoop Dogg, from that hurricane that devastated New Orleans again, and sighed because she had had to do what the original owners had no doubt done, turn Snoop loose when there was no way to afford his care and that of the humans she called kin. A tall, lanky dog with a smile as big as his whole body would get snatched up quickly and or would find sustenance in the re-encroaching wilds that were making clear that life was not as it used to be. The rolling electricity blackouts were far more frequent, making free internet connections almost impossible, and her long-abandoned hope to continue her college degree looked more and more like the right call. University power was intermittent too, and at least a dozen of the core faculty of her ethnic studies program had left the grid for places unknown. When last she checked, the registrar's office was on permanent hiatus, and the last Mass University email had made promises for another with more details of a plan that never came. It had been an entire semester, not that it mattered much anyway. She knew not to waste precious online time on a virtual class with the cost of, for using your camera in MetaZoom had increased. Apparently not that long ago, there was an airline that made customers buy everything piecemeal. You could get a seat, but if you wanted something else, like to bring a bag or eat something, it was an extra cost. Spirit Airlines spirited away more money than you'd think by making customers buy everything a la carte, and that simultaneously sucked the spirit right out of their patrons as they worried for their lives on every flight. Seems the internet company liked the strategy, and here we are paying again to access the classes we are paying for to help us get better jobs to better pay for the internet access we need to go to school. The Mobius strip of late stage capitalism's hold on her education didn't hold her attention much longer, as it was drowned out by the sounds of vibrant, if not verdant, outside. She listened from her place stretched out on the cement of the drive, covered by a long ago rusted overhang that could no longer protect a car from the elements. Her lower back gaped from the ground while her prodigious posterior and upper back made contact. Even with the food rationing, her ass remained defined, creating a small gap that, should there be a breeze, would feel incredible should it pass through, but no such luck. She heard the incessant singing of cicadas, cicadas that were supposed to die off after their multi-species appearance in 2024, but remained due to the changes in temperature. She sighed. At least there was always protein, even if it wasn't the kind that she remembered from her youth. Her ears perked up when she heard the generator kick on, and she cursed under her breath as she knew that she needed to move. She hated to be the bearer of bad news, but it was her job to dissuade her brother from wasting precious electricity on some multiplayer game with his internet friends. She huffed out a breath as she pulled herself off the supposedly cool cement to walk inside the too warm house.
Her brother was already preparing for the fight, his hand outstretched with his phone screen showing he had just transferred $50 into her account. "Before you tell me no, I sent you money for 20 minutes. It's Bandit's birthday, and we have to do this campaign when they were born, 3:25 p.m. my time, okay? Just 20 minutes." Deja sighed. She didn't have the heart to tell him that $50 would barely cover 5 minutes of play these days. She'd been shielding him from the hard truth so long she hadn't even noticed herself. At first, that paying for playtime was eating into their grocery money. She'd figure it out. She always did. It was her job as the big sister, especially when with her dad dead and mom in hospice due to the latest COVID strands. She was all he had. "All right, tell Bandit," I said, "happy solar return." "Can't you say happy birthday like a normal person?" She sighed again and playfully pushed his shoulder as she made her way to the kitchen on the hunt for food. She was surprised she actually had enough provisions for both of them for once. The vegetables were starting to rot, but perhaps the only plus of her newborn bout with COVID was that she couldn't smell anymore. She spritzed her hands with her vodka water mixture and waved them around, enjoying the cooling feeling as the alcohol evaporated. Lowering the age to buy alcohol to 16 to match the lowered age of the draft had the unexpected outcome of giving her access to the cheapest hand sanitizer she could find per ounce. She knew better than to drink it. She knew better than to drink it too, as another COVID kid side effect was weak livers and kidneys. She poured a little alcohol on a knife and cut away the rotted parts, tossing the scraps into the compost bag they kept in the ice chest until they had enough to make it worth taking the trip down to the community garden. It was wild to think people used to get fruit and vegetables in grocery stores, that there was a surplus that allowed some food to go to waste. She remembered seeing some of that reflected in what little media she'd been able to access growing up. Hard to believe that her first memories are of endless content, and now she can barely afford the 20 minutes for her brother to have a campaign with friends on their birthday. Sigh number three. She was brought back to the current moment by a faint, familiar knock on their front door. Ignored by her brother, Deja makes her way to the front to see who is calling, though given the pattern and pressure, she knew it was her friend LaMarcus. LaMarcus had been the only kid around her age in her community. Her parents' generation stopped having kids like that. Gen Z and Gen Alpha, too traumatized, socially inept, and just plain poor to have a kid, and certainly not more than one. She and her brother were an exception. 5 years between her 16 and his 11 made his birth and survival a surprise to her and her parents. She knew it hurt her mom, making the next time she had a foreign body to bear that much harder and leaving her worse for the wear. Deja turned the necessary locks and pulled up her cloth mask. She opened the door to see LaMarcus in a similarly sweat-suctioned t-shirt and his signature motorcycle helmet on his head. He had already stepped back the 6 feet from the door and flipped up the shade of the helmet to see his friend. "You didn't respond to the thing I sent," LaMarcus, launching into a conversation as if they'd both been having one. "You know I don't do that anymore. It's a waste of energy." "This isn't." He pulled his phone from his pocket and held it up so he could project the hologram he wanted to display. In scrolling marquee font, the hologram read, "Power to the People, a teach-in on electricity sponsored by the former union organizers of the East Point Power Plant. 30 minutes after sundown, food provided, child care, BSL interpretation, outside with distancing. So are we supposed to figure out how to run our own power plant now?" Deja scoffed, though curious. "I thought you'd be excited, a chance to create what we need instead of waiting on someone who's not coming to save us. She twirled it over in her head and looked over her shoulder at her brother's progress with his gaming friends, remembering his hard-won $50 offered to her with such certainty. Deja sighed again. Well, at least they decided to wait until after dark. So that's the story. And I'm going to stop there for just a moment and talk about what I was thinking about when I wrote it. Thank you. I wrote this story trying to think about where we're headed, particularly with the reality of climate change ever more apparent. What became clear to me was that gender mattered little to me in writing my story. I chose genders that reflected my communities, and I thought of sexualities of my characters. But when I used Midjourney, it became impossible to make my vision visible with simple language. So Midjourney works by users entering a prompt, and the algorithm tries to create a vision of what you mean based on the art and material it has in its system. So this is me trying to describe, and this is what the image becomes. So I entered dark-skinned, middle-aged black woman with a curly afro telling a story to her audience while they are all inside a bubble. And as you can see, Midjourney only puts her in the bubble and then also makes assumptions about who is in the audience because I specifically said black woman. So the audience then, of course, is imagined to be all black. And this is something that happens when you use a tool like this. There are certain assumptions that are built in that really mimic the things that we've seen in our world. So this is me trying to describe Deja, dark-skinned black girl, sweating with t-shirt stuck to her skin, lying on her back on a concrete driveway, looking up through a rusted carport in a sweltering apocalyptic future in Atlanta. And so this is how it's interpreting it. And obviously the rusted carport is not visible. We have the rust kind of on her body. So again, the algorithm is making certain choices about what it thinks I mean. Also note that I had to say dark-skinned because when I try to do this without making that specification, it always produced images of light-skinned black people. And so this is something else that the algorithm is doing. It's making assumptions about who is the prototype, who is imagined as that particular person. I also didn't specify that these were cis people. So again, the algorithm is assuming that anytime I say girl or woman, I mean cis. One of the things I wanted to do in thinking about the younger brother, I wasn't necessarily assuming that the brother's gender was necessarily confined. So when you say brother, it's also making assumptions about what that means in terms of ability and also size. You'll notice that all of the figures are pretty thin. Unless I did something that specifically said fat, I'm not going to get any images that actually represent the bodily diversity that we know exists in the world. So for this example, when I imagined LaMarcus, LaMarcus is actually the name of one of my favorite characters from the TV show P-Valley. His stage name is Lil Murder. And I imagined LaMarcus as this trans masculine friend. And of course, with this image, it's hard to tell what the algorithm is understanding and what it's not, given that description. So again, trying to figure out how do we actually create the language that these tools can understand to describe the breadth and depth of the communities that we come from and the communities that we care about. So as you can see, I put in language that I thought was clear of what should be on the flyer, and the algorithm chose some of it to take in and some of it not to take in. It's interesting that there's this repetition of Black Sign Language, BSL, BSL, which is not in the original text that I inputted. So again, the algorithm is making choices based on its own imagining that has little to do even with what I input. So it really begs the question of how we use these tools and what those tools can actually do for us. I am thinking about this also as a kind of tech that is being generated to make our lives, quote unquote, easier. But it feels like so many new tech tools forget that it's nourished by hierarchies that exist in our world and will therefore replicate them. So beyond the replication, we must also consider what happens when the tech doesn't work. Midjourney and other platforms assume that the internet is infinitely available, that electricity is not without material cost, and increasingly unstable in a world that is shifting. At the top of the talk, you heard me add a consideration of Congolese miners in the labor portion of my acknowledgement. I'm thinking about the current political unrest in the Democratic Republic of the Congo that is connected to stories like one told by Harvard lecturer Siddharth Karta, which describes the backbreaking work of searching for coltan or cobalt by a 15-year-old Elodi, who is exposed to toxic dust in the process. Elodi sells her coltan to Chinese distributors who export and refine the mineral in China, then sell it to tech companies to power our digital devices, such as smartphones, laptops like this one, and tablets. Due largely to activism from local Congolese groups and NGOs, the US passed the Dodd-Frank Act, which prohibits any commodity traded through the SEC from having conflict minerals in its supply chain. So in theory, this seems like a helpful provision, a way to ensure that companies take the human rights abuses and conflict profiteering now embedded in the digital supply chain seriously. However, most of these workers are like Elodi, involved in artisanal small-scale mining, which has little oversight. So what you see here is my asking the algorithm of Midjourney to create an image of child miners in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And what we see here is a reflection of who's actually doing this work. And of course, all of the things that are embedded in this really go against who is imagined, who is shown publicly as the face of these digital technologies that we take for granted. And so I've been thinking about what does it mean to use tech if we're not thinking about the people who, the hidden humans who are behind the tech that we use. In September 2019, China Labor Watch released a report revealing numerous labor violations of the Xinzhou Foxconn factory, the largest iPhone factory in the world, and known for its infamous suicide nets that surround its dormitories so that workers won't kill themselves if they decide to jump, as many have. China was accused of forcing Uyghur workers, Uyghur Muslims, to work at factories that produce goods for well-known global companies, including Apple, Nike, BMW, Samsung, Sony, and Volkswagen. And these human rights violations have been brought to the attention of these companies before, but like the Dodd-Frank Act, the kind of interventions designed to ameliorate these issues never seem to reach those most in need. In October, also of 2019, South Carolina granted Google a 4-year contract to allow them to extract and use 549 million gallons of groundwater a year to cool its latest data center in the state. Clay Duffy, who's the manager of Mount Pleasant Waterworks, opposed the transaction set, and he said, "I don't have a beef against Google itself, but I don't think it's appropriate to use pristine groundwater for cooling computers versus providing that water to people. We are obviously concerned about the long-term, safe, sustainable yield of our aquifer. The population of South Carolina is growing. Additionally, one outcome of COVID is an increase in the need for personal water consumption. So these data centers provide very little in the way of new jobs for the communities that host them, despite the increased use as a selling point. So even with a factory that's, you know, this big, they probably only hire about 30 workers to oversee and take care of these server farms. And so the question of what happens to South Carolinians who are trying to, you know, use this aquifer remains a question. So as a Lodi and 35,000 other Congolese children, upwards of 80,000 ethnic minorities negotiate dangerous working conditions that impair their health. Some Western consumers get to enjoy the fruits of their labor to fight for their own rights in the ableist infrastructure of the West on social platforms like X and TikTok. So it's really interesting to think about our ability to use these platforms in ways that are really wonderful and helpful to us, but our ability to use those platforms is built on some disabling and often really terrible things that happen to these hidden humans who are part of the supply chain. Additionally, Americans and people around the world benefit from the cooling power of the aquifers in South Carolina, water that is in the ground traditionally stewarded by the Catawba, the PD, the Chickara, the Estido, the Santee, the Yamasee, and Chickarawakama, who are still present in South Carolina, as are many descendants of the Cherokee. What are the ethical implications of using stolen water on stolen land to cool the data centers that power our digital devices and tools like Midjourney? How might a new set of relations between consumers, laborers, and land create the kind of advocacy that would force corporate entities to change their policies? So I think that the answer to these questions require a bit of fictional science, which allows us to imagine alternative futures so that we might realize them. So that's kind of where I was coming from with the story. But I got that idea from Banu Subramaniam, who deploys the fictional science in her compelling text, Ghost Stories for Darwin. In chapter 3 of her book, Singing the Morning Glory Blues, Subramaniam tells the fictional story of three childhood best friends and their love for a field of morning glories near their home as a way to explore what a just scientific practice could be. The girls are inadvertently inspired to be interdisciplinary scholars by the strict disciplinary boundaries observed by the adults who study the field of flowers via their own strict fields of study. In the book, there are scientists who collect soil samples with grad students and others who use math to make sense of the flowers. The dozen or so researchers don't talk to each other, and when that doesn't go well, the girls hatch a plan to bring the investigators together. But after a night of food and fun, the scientists attempt to talk to each other, only to storm off upset. The girls take the scientists' different approaches to heart, and ultimately they become scientists themselves and work collaboratively with each other and their community and create research that transforms their world. So they create their own science lab that becomes a community partnership that builds on the relationships of their community over time. They envision scientific study as a collaborative and community-centered endeavor. And I believe this chapter really provides a window into what science can be positing an ethical practice that involves the participation and collaboration of researchers' communities and an attention to not just humans in the process. So with that in mind, I started to think about what we might imagine, what a future could look like. So I am imagining a future life on a server farm commune where I tend to the whirs and beeps, turn flashes of light powered by the sun and wind. The community of server farmers exist on land in right relation with the traditional stewards of the region. I envision one such server farm outside the city limits of Detroit, where the Anishinaabe, the Ottawa, Ojibwe, and Potawatomi have navigated the land for centuries. Our presence was sanctioned by the indigenous communities that traditionally use the land, and they have access to all the servers they want and need. We work together to make sure our disruption of the regular comings and going of flora and fauna are minimized, finding natural clearings and erecting structures that fit the landscape and diffuse the energy and heat generated by the power required to run the servers. To that end, there are internet quiet hours where the internet sleeps as we do. Light pollution is eradicated and electrical waves are reduced. We can communicate with similar such communities around the world by essentially writing letters back and forth that may reach our pen pals instantly, but are only opened in the light of day in the time zone received. Given the taxing nature of the digital on the environment, we make every effort to limit our activity and connectivity, and we use it judiciously. We work to harness natural energy sources through new technology like lightning collectors and ambient energy harvesters. We move at the speed of trust, the speed of our circadian rhythm, remaining conscious of the pace at which we want our lives to proceed. The farm is not only for servers, but also for food. And we reuse the bits of e-waste that cannot be refurbished or recycled for fences and planters. Kids learn to code as they learn to plant. We learn how to solder our own servers, creating the technology we need at a sustainable pace. We eat well and have digital dance parties. It's a different way of relating to the world, IRL and online. Gender and sexuality are in the background. Identity matters less than what you do and how you move in right relation with all that's around you. So I want to end there because now I'm gonna ask you to think of these stories yourselves. So we're gonna take just 5 minutes. I'm gonna play a little music for you. If you all use something like Midjourney or DALL-E, feel free to fire it up on your phone or whatever. Also, if you are able to just write, we're gonna take 5 minutes for you to write your own short story and think about these questions for yourself, okay? So if anybody wants to share their story in the Q&A or their image that they create, they can. I'm gonna play 5 songs. They're a minute each and they're instrumental, okay? If you want to share your story with me and with the audience, you can at me on X at MoyaZB, or you can at me at MoyaZB, at MoyaZB Blue Sky Social. Thank you.
Do folks need or want more time? Yeah, a little more time? Okay. So I want to say thank you all for taking the time to listen and participate, and we'll open it up for Q&A and anyone who wants to share. Thanks.
Thank you. I was wondering, when you were writing your short story, some of the little details you included about what the future was like, I was wondering where you got the inspiration or maybe information for them. Some of them seem really grounded in our reality, like the inevitable downfall of Spirit Airlines. But you included details like the lowering of the draft age and really vivid imagery about these rolling electrical blackouts and stuff. So I was just wondering where you got these. Where you got these details from that seemed really grounded, and your story was beautiful, but a unfortunately realistic dystopia.
Yeah, thank you. I think I draw on the tradition of Octavia Butler and looking at the world around me to see what tracks for the future. I was thinking a lot about what happened in Texas when the power grid went down, when it got so cold that the grid couldn't support electricity and so many people were freezing literally to death during that time. I was also thinking about the very real issue of the electricity going out even contemporarily in different parts of the world. I mentioned the Sudan. They also had an electricity outage as part of what's happening there. This question is something that's happening in many parts of the world outside of the US already. So it seems inevitable that that's something that's gonna come here. I do think we live in a bubble where we get to think that these things are far away, but they're actually a lot closer and they're already happening. Thanks. In the back.
Why is it that you chose to have BSL as a central part of your story? And why aren't our world doing more things to be able to give people the ability to communicate? Because I feel like I should not know like 20 Geiger-olds that still don't have access to basic eye gaze technology and really can't communicate with people still, and they're 20.
Great question. So I thought of BSL because East Point, Georgia is where I lived when I was doing graduate school, and it's a primarily Black community.
just outside of Atlanta. So it felt important to think about Black Sign Language. That was the first kind of sign language that I saw, even before I saw ASL. So that's what made me think about that. What does accessibility look like for the communities where people are? And yes, I think this is part of my question and how I think about the internet and the digital generally. It can be so helpful and create so many opportunities. At the same time, it's not equally distributed. It's not something that everybody has access to. And actually, the creation of the material pieces of the internet can actually be disabling for a lot of people around the world. And we don't have that conversation either. So part of this talk was trying to think through that as well.
Hello. Oh my gosh. Hi. Thank you so much for coming. My question pertains to your work at Northwestern about digital apothecary in the first, would it be an archive of the sort? And about the medical industry, like recently in Alabama, frozen embryos are now considered humans, and like have the legal, all the legal rights and ramifications of that. And I'm curious what your, I guess your take on how, what that can look like for the future and like the implications of eugenics ideology informing that and all, like and how IVF is normally only accessible to like wealthy cis het white couples. And now with like the legalization of those frozen embryos, how we are going to see what is considered a body in the future, and I mean what that is now, but then where that could, that is heading. Sorry, that was really, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's really scary to think about what's happening at state legislature at that level. And it's something that unfortunately it's hard to build energy around. It's not an easy fight, and people don't often have the patience for the bureaucracy that's happening at the state legislature. But one of the things that I was thinking about in terms of this story and things that I've seen before, as things get worse and as things deteriorate, it also creates opportunities and openings for people to resist in new ways. So I'm also thinking about us moving towards, you know, resisting and challenging those particular laws by strategies that people are already employing that we've seen now. So for example, when we think about abortion rights, something that's happening already is that people are flying, driving, making opportunities for pregnant people to get to other states where they can get the services that they need. And I imagine that those are some of the strategies that are going to be used in these cases as well. I also think that people are going to push back even more in their local environments. And to be honest, I think we're in a position where the people of power are, I don't know, losing their interest in certain spaces. So I also am thinking about a place like East Point, Georgia, where there's been a big disinvestment in the people who generally have power. And so there's also the opportunity for people to take back and reclaim those spaces as their own. So I think it's a bit of both and. I don't feel, interestingly, even as I write this sort of post-apocalyptic sad tale, I also have a lot of hope of people figuring out what they need and pushing back in ways that they can. Yeah, that's for you.
Thank you so much. So I'm going to control myself. I have like five things I want to ask, but I'm going to limit myself. First of all, I have to say I had never used Midjourney before, and I just played with it, and it's disturbing. So thank you for that. I think but that was it's fascinating. But so I had two questions, I guess. One was what you were just talking about hope and imagining something that isn't maybe sad or even apocalyptic. So I'm wondering if you might talk a little bit about when you imagine a world otherwise, a vision of something that is that feels good, yeah. Right? So is that just fantasy? Is it foolish? So I would love for you to talk a little bit about that. The other piece is I would love for you to say more about what you were getting at the beginning of your talk, where you were addressing the ways in which gender and sexuality were and weren't showing up for you and what you were prioritizing. And a move away from identity and towards something else. And so I would love for you to get at that too. And maybe those are related.
I think they are. Thank you for those questions. So this image is one that I created in Midjourney. And I want to say, I didn't want to tell you what I put in to generate this, because I thought it was, to me, a really fun example of what could be possible if we actually imagine a world where we are in right relation with the land. I was trying to think about what would be the least intrusive for the environment. And part of what I mean by getting away from identity, I think when gender and sexuality are understood only as identity, we can miss the ways that we have to think about how we actually are with each other, how we relate to one another. So much of what I've been thinking about now has been community. How do we stay together? How do we move in a world that has so often made us individuals that doesn't have us thinking about community or collectivity? And to me, there's something about identity as it's been used sometimes that becomes more about the individual than about a collective. And I think about other communities that have various practices around sex, sexuality, and gender that don't necessarily use the language of identity to describe those. And this is an issue that we've seen in terms of human rights actions that are kind of imposed from the West on communities of color around the world who have different ways of thinking about sex and sexuality that aren't based in identity. And so sometimes we lose some of that specificity that actually values community and collectivity in new ways or in different ways. And I wouldn't even say new, but in more traditional ways that attend to the community more. There was actually this interesting thing that's happened recently in Thai and Filipino social media. There was a Thai trans woman who was beat up by some Filipino trans women, and the story went viral because a straight cis Thai man stood up for the Thai trans woman, and it's become kind of this story that has generated over a million tweets and social media impressions. And one of the things that the Thai community was saying specifically was like, we're Thai, we're gonna support her no matter what. And one of the things that they were saying is Thai men, Thai cis straight men, are probably one of the few communities where men will go up for trans women like that in support, in solidarity. And so I think we have a lot to learn in terms of what we value and what we put forward. It's interesting. I mean, I think we should critique the nationalism of that, you know? I'm not saying that should be our new normal, but I do think that there's something important about how we imagine and think through our connections and who we imagine as kin, who we keep close. Yeah.
Can you? Yeah, okay. Thank you so much for being here again. I was thinking about when you said, I illustrate with the tool that I critique, and I wanted to ask if you could talk a little bit more about navigating, working within this, I guess, like art making, but also thinking about AI in the sense, and how you work with it for software that not just doesn't represent BIPOC folks, but also doesn't even recognize them sometimes, most of the times.
Yes, I mean, this was probably, this is something I've been thinking about because students have brought this to my attention. I wasn't really using Midjourney before in my own work, but it's something that my students brought and something that they were using. And so I wanted to understand it, play around with it. And in the process, it has made me and continues to make me uncomfortable for exactly those reasons. I think it's important for people to see, though, what the tool does and to show the limits of it so that people can start to imagine something else. There's a possibility of something being opened up when you use the tools that are available to you and you reach the limits of those tools and you realize how they do and don't work. And I think that's one of the things that inspires people to create the next thing and something that is more in line and more possible to represent and reflect and also imagine something else for communities. One of the things I didn't mention that's really interesting about Midjourney is that the prompt you use to create something is called imagine. So it's imagine and then a slash. So it's asking you to take your prompt and imagine something with it. But that imagining is limited by the people who create it. And so we have to again see how so much of our hierarchies, et cetera, remain in the tech that we use, that it's not objective.
Hi, my name is Cassidy. And I'm minoring in health studies, and recently we were discussing in one of my classes. Sorry, this is me. We were discussing like potential AI-backed softwares to sort of fill some roles that medical professionals use. And this was one of the things that came up, was that the prejudices that humans hold are like in there. I don't really know how these things are coded and set up and stuff, but I guess I'm wondering, is there a way that we can sort of break this chain of like prejudice from humans into prejudice of AI into further perpetuating assumptions and prejudices that people hold?
So one thing I got from my gender studies education was that humans all have biases, but some biases are better than others. And so this is what I think about when I consider standpoint theory, that some people, based on their positionality, have a perspective that can be actually really useful in seeing the limits of certain realities because they are in a marginalized position. And marginality doesn't automatically mean that people have this perspective, of course, but there's more potential for someone to have a view that actually moves things in new directions because of that positionality. And when we look at people who make AI, we look at people who are in positions of power, you know, there's not a lot of diversity in those rooms. And by diversity, I don't just mean people who have the markers of marginal position in terms of their race, class, or gender. I'm also thinking about people who have a unique perspective because of that subject position, who would be able to move these technologies in new ways. And I think the only way that AI will improve is if we have more collaborative and also users who are part of the process, and then it's not so separated in terms of people who make and create and those who then use or are managed by those projects or by those products. I just saw a TikTok recently talking about this move in nursing to AI nursing. There's a shortage of nurses in the country, and so they've started to try to predict and manage what people are feeling, having cameras in hospital rooms and remote nurses who are checking on more and more patients via this tool and technology. And I just think that, you know, when we have capitalism very much built into these systems of care, that's where we're never going to actually get to, I think, the health in healthcare, or the care in healthcare that we actually want. Yeah. There. And then.
Is it working? Okay. Hello, my name is Ariana Williamson, and my group is representing the Washington State University Women's Center. So the question prior to mine was kind of similar, but I wrote mine a little bit differently. So I just asked, considering the AI revolution and its impact on shaping perspectives, considering its lasting effects of confirmation bias as it assigns gender, race, and other characteristics to stereotypes as you described in your story, should we see this as another form slash modern oppression? And especially since how you just stated healthcare and AI being used in multiple different ways, and how it's an AI revolution, and it's kind of a scary thing how much it's taking over.
Yes. I am interested in automation. I think there's a way that feminists have thought about automation in ways that could be helpful to people. You know, initially people thought dishwashers are gonna change the game. That's gonna help erase and deal with the division of labor that's happening in households. They didn't do that. So I think that we have to actually deal with the ideas behind the tech before the tech leads. The tech can't do what we're not willing for it to do. If we haven't addressed the root issue of patriarchy, white supremacy, you know, cis normativity, if we haven't done that, then the tools are going to replicate exactly what we see in society. The tool can't lead. There's this version of something Toni Morrison says, like, love is never better than the lover. And I think about this in this context too, like a tool is only as good as the people wielding it. And if we haven't done our work, then AI is just going to replicate the things that we see in society. So we have to actually address those things first, I think.
Thank you. So I've recently used Midjourney quite a bit because I work for a school's IT department. And a couple weeks ago, I gave a presentation on bias in AI, specifically using Midjourney. And that was within kind of connection to how Midjourney pictured professors at this school and schools like our own. And just like a general prompt, they were all cishet old white men in tweed or plaid with a beard usually. And then if you were to like specify by subject, a lot of them would look like Kim. If you were to do like for gender studies specifically, language was kind of all the same. Like it was only like ethnic studies and gender studies where they looked any different. But my question, I guess, is with Midjourney, the way it's set up with like the, it's on Discord, as you know, but like they try and make you have this like sort of collaborative sort of thing where all of the prompts that every single person uses just shows up all at once in this endless feed, which I found very annoying. But I was curious if you thought that was a way, like if that affected your use of it at all, or like what other people saw or said or commented affected that, and if you think that might be a way to try and lessen the very inherent biases in it.
That's such a good question. I mean, I too find that a bit overwhelming. It's such a continuous stream, it's hard to keep up. But honestly, what I generally see there are things that very much map on to what we see in society. I've not seen the kinds of moving away from a more normative expression. And I think that's also because of how it's built, because even when you try to create prompts and prompt in a way that should push the algorithm in different ways, you still get the same things. You know, the algorithm doesn't want to understand the things that actually would push it in a new direction. And so that's one of the things that's been pretty frustrating for me. Another thing that I've tried to do, I was trying to, for another project, create some representation of, again, transmasculine or masculine women. And Midjourney is like, I don't know what you're talking about. Its understanding of what women is very limited. And that, to me, says a lot about who's training, what material the AI is trained on, and what needs to shift for our realities to actually be represented. And that's a thing about shifting the material that is used to create the tool. Thanks. Do I see a hand? The overalls? Yeah.
Hi, thank you for your wonderful talk. I really enjoyed all of it. This is kind of similar to Cass's question, but I'm curious as to how you see like the healthcare industry and like how it's currently functioning today fit into this world that goes with the story of what you have projected on the screen, and how you kind of envision balancing like the very like advanced and very expensive and specialized tech that goes into it with all of these like very different and like very pressing important matters. Thank you.
Honestly, I feel as though until healthcare is not tied to people's ability to pay, we're not gonna see anything that's different. And that's also part of the reason that AI in healthcare exists, is because it's trying to be a cost-saving measure for insurance companies. And it's really creating a situation where care is not part of the equation. Something I've seen people talk about, the US is one of the few, I think the only actually, quote unquote, developed country that doesn't have midwives as a standard part of the birthing process. And that has, of course, really affected Black women particularly and Black pregnant people. And that has created a situation where it's gonna take more than just using an AI tool, whatever it is, to address something simple. And I guess that's kind of going back to something I mentioned before about the digital apothecary, which is my lab. I chose that name because I'm thinking about the digital as something future and kind of moving into the future, but then apothecary is something old and dated, and trying to hold those two things in tension. And something that happens now is there's a move towards the shiny new tool that to me sometimes misses that humans are part of technology, that we are communities, and the things that we know how to do for each other, with each other, are a tech that we don't rely on enough. And so many of the issues that we have, I think, won't be solved by tech, will actually be solved by our ability to work together and what community can look like. Two down here.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. So in my ethnic studies class, we've been talking a lot about the idea of how race is nothing if not for racism, and how racism is used to perpetuate our capitalist system and the patriarchy, which is what drives the tech industry. So I'm wondering how the ideology of race is used to guide technological advancements like AI.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the ways that I'm thinking initially of the work of Ruha Benjamin, looking at how hand dryers and sinks, faucets, you know, that are supposed to recognize anybody's hand often don't recognize people with dark skin. And then this also takes me back to the health question and thinking about dermatology as a field that often doesn't have representations of certain skin conditions for people who have darker skin. There have been a lot of different ways that people have been trying to address these issues, but it ends up being rather piecemeal. You know, as something comes up, then we're addressing it here. As it comes up, we're addressing it here. As opposed to, again, going back to this bigger view of trying to deal with what is happening with our world that we haven't been able to think about the way some of these bigger systems are impacting our daily lives. So for me, it goes back to, when do we get this education? Why is it only happening on college campuses? We've seen this also in the move, you know, the myth of critical race theory in K through 12 education. I do think that there's a need for these conversations to happen sooner and for people to have access to it, not just through the educational system. So I turn to art and other forms of connection that people have access to, whether they've been in school or not, as another way to bring this conversation to a wider group of people. Yeah, last question.
So I really appreciate how you talk so much about like focusing more on community, especially with regard to gender and sexuality. And I'm just wondering if you can expand more on what you consider community, like especially in our digital age when you can be connected to someone all the way across the world. But then I also feel like in your story and that picture up there, the community focus was more on like the people who you're intimately with in person. And so I'm just wondering sort of how do you reconcile those in community?
I so appreciate that question. There's research that suggests that people really like college because your people are near you, your food is near you, it's walkable a lot of times or accessible in other ways. College campuses are spaces where many, if not all, of your needs are met in a contained environment. And I think in the push for globalization and also the size of nation states and even states in the United States, it's difficult to actually create the kind of community that can be accountable to each other. That is more possible when we're in smaller groups. So part of the reason I was thinking about community in my story at the level of a small city like East Point, Georgia, was that it seems like an attainable size, that it is possible for a community to learn from the people who run the power plant or who have run it in the past how to do that. What does it mean to think about creating the tools and the communities that we need to get our needs met when we're not seeing that happen at these larger levels? It's hard to scale community. It's hard to scale for people's needs. And I want us to think about making that more possible. How can that be integrated into society in more ways? College campuses also are their own little bubbles, for good and for ill. The way that town and gown divide happens has been an issue for a lot of different communities, but I think it would be so cool if communities around college campuses had access to the kinds of resources that are on the campuses that are in their communities. What would it mean for a community to include, you know, your neighbors? And what does it mean to actually know your neighbors, which is something that's not happening in the United States in large part because of the hyper-individualism that we've come to expect. So I would say I'm thinking about kin and community at a scale that we can actually hold. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming this evening. Please join us in the lobby for a reception where you can buy a copy of one of Dr. Moya Bailey's books and talk with our speaker. We have another full day of events tomorrow. We hope to see you there. And please join me in thanking once again the wonderful Dr. Moya Bailey.